Good afternoon, everybody. I thank the organizers at the outset for giving me this opportunity. Without much ado, I'll start with what I have to do today. So this, what we are seeing today is a complex subset of patients. We always feel that they're not treated appropriately most of the times. And just I'll show you, I mean, how best we can manage them in possible ways. So patients with abdominal aortic aneurysm, this will tell you that anything more than 5.5 centimeters needs treatment, and anything more than 8 or 9 needs emergent treatment. It's always debated whether EVAR or surgery is the best, and always thought it was previously, before EVAR was there, all patients used to go for surgery. Now I think the endovascular aneurysm repair is an option. So patients sees their, I mean, like high risk patients, as well as if you think that the anatomy is very suitable, then probably EVAR should be considered. And this is the meta-analysis which has shown that. You can see the line there in the middle. All the trials are showing that, I mean, like the initial period, I mean, like they were favoring EVAR, and later part with the longer duration, the surgery and EVAR are better. I mean, like surgery starts becoming better as the time progresses. So these are all the studies which are shown. The most important one is the DREAM trial. So how do we do this? I mean, how do you manage the abdominal aortic aneurysm endovascularly? The heart of the management is basically CT, so imaging. So any patient comes to us, I mean, like the most important thing is get a good CT done. And these are all the things which have to be measured. I mean, like better to take the help of a radiologist. See, most important part is the neck of the aneurysm. I mean, like whatever we call aortic neck diameter. So this is the proximal landing zone where our aortic stent is going to stay. And this is the aneurysm. And this length should be minimum of 15 to 20 mm, which is needed. And this size, as you can see here, the landing zone, I mean, the maximum size of the aorta there permitted is 32 mm, because the stent sizes which are available, they suit only up to that diameter. And this most important thing which you have to notice is the neck angulation. You can see there the proximal segment and the aortic aneurysm segment. The angulation of the neck is very important for the device, because if this angle is more than 45 to 60 degrees, there is a high chance of endoleak here. If the device won't get aligned to the proximal segment, and the blood seeps in between the stent and the vessel wall. So these are very important. Most important thing to look at is the access site. The extraniliac artery where we access the artery, we should have minimum of 7 to 8 mm there. So these are all very important when you are considering a patient for abdominal aortic aneurysm repair. So there are many devices are available. So these are the devices which are available in a chest actually. But what is important to know is, I mean, you should always read the product manual, and we should get used to using one or two devices at the most. I mean, like, you cannot keep repeating devices all the time. So get used to one or two devices, be good with them, and keep trying to keep using those devices. These are the FDA-approved devices. So when you are doing EVAR, I mean, like, it's possible to do a stent graft in three ways, actually. So if the aneurysm is limited to the segment above the bifurcation, you just do a tubular graft below the renal arteries up to the bifurcation and stop before the bifurcation. If the aneurysm is extending into the iliac arteries, then we cannot get away with stopping before the bifurcation. So we have to extend the limbs into the iliac arteries and do a bifurcated graft. This is a rare scenario where if the iliac left or right iliac artery ostial it's occluded, then you can do a graft directly into one iliac and we can get away with it. So that's a kind of easier scenario. So I'll just tell you how it is done basically. So usually it is a femoral cut down. We put a wire into the descending thoracic aorta. And this aortic stent graft has a limb which extends into the iliac artery on one side, and it has a gate on the other side. So basically what it does is it has radiopaque markers on both the sides. And when we are introducing the device, we should make sure that the marker is exactly, I mean, like there will be external marker which indicates this limb, the shorter limb. So we see that the marker is aligned. I mean, it is whatever side it is, we have to make sure that the marker is on the same side. Then you go inside and you deploy the graft into the aneurysm in the proximal landing zone, and see that this limb is hanging here above it. Then as a next step, you can just take another contralateral femoral artery puncture and then access this limb, and then you put a cover stent here and then finish off the procedure. You can put another limb and then cover. So this, sometimes there can be difficulty in cannulation of this gate. So the other way is you can access the same site, go in from this side contralateral, and you can come out of this gate and then access the artery. So there are a few techniques which sometimes what happens is this gate may get jailed here, somewhere here, or somewhere here. So I mean, like, you can poke. There are some techniques where you can access that gate somehow. So that was about the aortic aneurysm. So when we see the other subset of patient, that is thoracic aortic aneurysm, so these are the guidelines. Anything more than 4 is abnormal, more than 5.5 to 6, they need treatment. And based on the congenital disorder, I mean, the guidelines change. And you can see there, most of them, none of them are class 1 indication. You can see there, all of them are like 2A, 2B kind of recommendations. So still, surgery has a role. So we should always choose patients wisely here. So if you see ascending aortic aneurysm, most of them, they go for surgery. Very rarely, there can be few favorable anatomies where we can do a stent graft. So this was the meta-analysis which showed that because they compared both the therapies. And this, what was seen was that endovascular aneurysm repair was losing its efficacy over a long period of time. So probably the surgery was giving better results over the long term, but our enthusiasm for devices won't die, and we keep innovating devices, so probably the results are going to change. These are the devices which are available for TIVAR, and again, you can see there, we should be acquainted with one or two devices, and we have to keep using them to understand them. So again, do a CT. Here, the most important thing to understand is the neck of the aortic arch. You can see there, the proximal landing zone, the graft will sit here. So if there is a lot of gap here, there is a high chance that for endoleak, so the blood will seep in through the wall and the graft. So we should make sure that this is not a very wide angle neck, and there should be significant proximal and distal landing zone. Minimum of 20 mm on either side is needed. So the aorta is divided into these zones for sake of understanding and planning. And here, at least 10 to 20% of oversizing is done when choosing a diameter of the graft. And the vessel is sized from inner wall to inner wall, and minimum of 20% oversizing is mostly needed. And whether when doing this, when you want to cover the left subclavian artery is controversial, because this is one of our patients recently we did. You can see there the graft, the aneurysm is starting below, but we needed this part so to prevent the endoleak. The graft was deployed across the left subclavian artery and patient is doing fine. So most of the times, unless they have a history of previous abdominal repair, so we can contently cover the left subclavian artery. So paraplegia is one of the dreaded complications. So always we have to keep looking for it. These are some subsets of patients are at risk for this. And in such kind of patients, it's better to do a spinal drainage. All of the procedures is done most of the time under general anesthesia. It can be done in local, but is preferred. And femoral cut down is better, but we can use vascular closure devices like Perclose, one or two devices, and then we can finish it off. So this is the device device which is used. We have used this device. This is a Ankura by LifeTech device. This has a longitudinal spine which reinforces the greater curvature of the aorta. So this, you can see there, once you push the over the wire, we put a extra stiff wire, and then this device is taken inside. And you can release the device by pulling back the trigger mechanism. Then there is a secure buckle which we push it with your thumb and then it goes out. Then you pull back the black releaser this thing. The tip which is still held into the proximal part of the graft gets deployed. You can see there from this one of our patients who had a thoracic aortic aneurysm. So you can see there, this is the nose cone which is there in the proximal end. Once you pull that black knuckle, I mean, it just leaves it and the graft gets deployed. The proximal release mechanism, this helps in proper position of the graft. I mean, you don't need rapid pacing and all. So this helps in proper deployment. So one of the main reasons for surgery is, I mean, what happens to the side branches? If there is involvement of the carotid or any renal arteries in, so how do you do that? So there are two ways where we manage the side branches. Either you can do a branch graft or you can do a hybrid branching. Hybrid is where the branches are taken care of by the surgeon and we take care of the main aneurysm. You see one of our patients, this was an aortic aneurysm, and he had severe left common carotid artery stenosis, and he had a dominant left vertebral. So he had two vessels here, so and he had aneurysm here. We had to cover the left subclavian. So this patient underwent a subclavian to subclavian artery bypass here, and then we could contently cover the aneurysm with the graft. So this is what, this is one of our patients seen a few days back. We are planning this. This patient had a thoracoabdominal aneurysm with severe SMA stenosis and mild celiac artery stenosis, and both renals are involved. So he can do this. He is sent for surgery now, and plan is to do the grafts to all the three visceral branches, debranch all the visceral arteries, and then cover with a stent graft from here to here. So do we always need to do this as a hybrid procedure? There are ways where we can complete it by endovascular approach. See, what we do is called parallel stent grafts are used. So you can see, I mean, the renal artery, there's a small stent graft which goes into both renals, and a graft is placed over the stent grafts. You can see cross-section, it looks like this, something like a oval, and two small parallel grafts are running for both renal arteries. Between. The major concern here is because there are small areas which are left behind here. So how do we do this? I mean, like, you put a wire into the renal artery, and then you place a self-expanding, balloon-mounted covered stent in the renal artery, and then you take a aortic stent graft, place it over it, and then you deploy the aortic stent graft, crush the whatever stent is there in the renal artery. Then you inflate the renal artery, and then you pull out it. So you know the renal artery stent, I mean, it has to extend beyond the covered stent for the renal artery to perfuse. So this is how it is done. You can see there the main problem with this is the covered stent and these are the chimneys which are there. So there are a few spaces here. These are the major cause for endoleak. So the main problem with this technique was there is a high chance of endoleak in these patients. So to some extent, we can prevent this by taking a big balloon in the aortic stent graft, crush these stents, and then you the balloons which are still there in the stent, you expand them again. So to some extent, we can get away with some endoleak. So all complex anatomies can be tackled with this. You can see there the carotid, chimney done to carotid, and chimney is done to visceral arteries as well. So the periscope is nothing but a chimney technique where the stent graft is perfusing retrogradely. So stent is ending here, the blood is perfusing retrogradely into the chimney. This is like a variant of chimney technique. Always oversize a little bit more when you are doing chimney. Sandwich is nothing but kind of chimney, parallel graft, where within one graft, there are two grafts are placed like this. So how do we better the results of this? So what it was innovated was to have a fenestration built into the graft. So the holes which are made into the graft, they sit over the renal artery ostia, whatever artery is diseased, I mean, we want to perfuse, the fenestration exactly sits over that artery. So this is all again by planning. So this is very important to see that, locate the ostia before with the CT, and then you need to look at all 3D imaging and all. Then locate the visceral arteries on the graft, you mark them, and then make holes there, reinforce the holes, and while deploying the graft, make sure that the fenestrations, they sit on the whatever arteries you want to perfuse, make sure. So it looks very complicated, but with proper planning, it's possible to see that the device sits within 5 to 10 degrees of the art and 5 mm of the ostia which have to be covered. This is a very interesting concept where they found that, I mean, they have off-the-shelf devices where the fenestrations are already made. It's anatomically, the celiac artery, renals, and SMA have a relation so that they are located like this. You can see their celiac SMA. This is the clock face, cross-section of the aorta, and they're located such that the celiac and SMA are within 11 to 1 o'clock. And they tried these off-the-shelf devices, and they could fit like 70 to 85% of patients, even without, I mean, like customizing for each person. So there is some kind of anatomical consistent relationship between these arteries. So probably the cannulation also may be easier. So this is how it is planned. You can see this is a cross-section of the aorta. So you know the clock face where if the renal artery comes here, if the SMA comes here or celiac comes here, you mark it. This is based on the CT. This is the plane which is there. So this is all done by the manufacturer to some extent. And then they'll give you the graft, or these can be modified by the physician on the table as well, before the table. So how it is done, just a couple of minutes. This fenestrated graft, you put in like, you want to do a fenestration, for example, to this renal artery, fenestrated graft to these renal arteries. You take access from the femoral, both femorals, this we are going to use for the graft. This you put in one catheter, another catheter from the right or left subclavians or brachials, and then you keep the catheters in the renal, both renal arteries. Now, we know where the renal ostia are there based on these catheters. Now you take the graft from the right femoral, you see that the fenestrations are there based on the anatomical location of the catheters, and you deploy this graft here. And then you go back to the your brachial approach, take another catheter into the graft, cannulate the fenestration, and then you put a covered stent in from the renal artery into the main graft. So finally you balloon dilate the graft, and then you are able to achieve a good seal here. So and then this has been shown that in best of hands, this is better than any chimney done, because the chance of endoleaks are very less with this technique. But this is little technical demanding when compared to chimney. So if you see chimney and fenestrated graft, chimneys are better in an emergency situation when patient is crashing and you want to do the procedure very fast. Chimney can be done very fast, and but this has needs a lot of planning before we do. So and follow-up is very important. Once we do the patient, we should never forget. 1 month CT, 6 month CT, and CT every year is a must. Most important complication is endoleak. You can see there if the endoleak is occurring proximally or distally, it's type 1. And if the blood fills through the colletars like this, it is a type 2 endoleak. And type 3 is where the fabric of the stent gets disrupted or some other reason. Type 1 and type 3, always treat them very fast. They're going to progress with the enlargement of the aneurysm, and they can give us trouble. So these are some new things happening. So mainly important is genetic association in aortic diseases. So very important to see, look for genetic syndromes. Genetic analysis is indicated in most of them, as well as first degree relatives. And there are many potential biomarkers role for them. So D-dimer we already know. So there is a lot of research going on this, how the biomarkers will help us in understanding the progression of these diseases. IVUS use, yes, they're trying to see how IVUS can help us to understand these diseases better. So there's a lot of scope for innovations as well as understanding of these diseases. Mainly the device of endovascular process is going to evolve.